Dear audience, good morning, everyone, and I would like to welcome all of you and welcome our guest today is Professor Ewa Czuchry. Ewa did her PhD in 2003 under the supervision of Professor Kijowski at Warsaw University Physics Department in Theoretical Physics, and she worked first in the Cathedral for Mathematical Methods in Physics at the Warsaw University, and also had a postdoctoral position for 2 years in Yukawa Institute for Theoretical Physics in Kyoto, Japan. Between 2007 and this year, she was a faculty member at the National Center for Nuclear Research, and in 2018, she did habilitation there. From this month, she has been appointed as an associate professor at the Department of Applied Mathematics and Computer Science at the Military University of Technology. So congratulations, Ewa, on your job, and welcome to give us a talk about Horabali-Fried gravity.
So I would like to
and find... no military secrets. In the
Yes, and I don't wear a uniform because I have a lot of questions about that law. But I'd like to thank the organizer for inviting me here, and I am happy to see some people that I know for many years. Today, I will talk generally about tracing possible Lorentz invariance breaking in some high-energy astronomical data. For that, I will use a parameter which was introduced in Horabali-Fried's gravity. That's further, the name of the talk is energy flow of lambda. So this parameter that control Lorentz invariance in this model in Horabali-Fried cosmology.
No, what Lipschitz? Eugenic Lipschitz?
I will write at that. So generally know that the general relativity, classical general relativity, in spite of its very wide theoretical success and experimental validation, like the recent one discovering measuring gravitational waves, is not renormalizing. So if we want to quantum this theory, we cannot use well-known methods of quantum field theory. The idea is that adding higher special derivatives term to Lagrangian makes the theory renormalizable at high energies. And I will talk about this in detail in the next slide. The price for this is giving up the idea of the space-time invariance under four dimensional diffeomorphism. So there is some not recent from 15 years ago a proposal of a gravity model by Horava. This is Czech name. So he proposed gravity which is equipped with anisotropic scaling called Lifshitz scaling at the Planck scale. And giving in the low energies, giving the limit, classical limit. There are many, since the time, there are many formulations of that theory. Today, I will focus on the two minimum ones with the minimum number of parameters. Also, since the time, there have been several attempts to put observational bounds on these Horabali-Fried gravity parameters. With my ex-PhD students, we published some 4 years ago. Today, I will talk about some results from our more recent papers. Let me first sketch the problem with general relativity. So-called natural units when Planck constant and speed of light are equal to one, gravitational constant g has the dimension of mass to the power minus two. If we want to expand a given physical quantity F in terms of these gravitational coupling constants, like here, if it is supposed to be divergent, the energy of the system squared must be greater than inverse of gravitational cost. Because this product is a scalar, doesn't have dimension. So it is expected that the perturbative effects in quantum field theory are broken when energy exits this scale. So it is in this sense GR is often said to be non-perturbatively renormalized. There has been many ideas to overcome this. One of them is adding to gravitational action, to the usual Einstein-Hilbert action, a quadratic term like this. Such adding changes gravitational propagator from 1 over k squared to the following one. We skip the higher terms. Okay, so at the high energies, this propagator is dominated by this term. So the high energy UV divergence can be cured. However, this modified theory is now not unitary. So we have two poles. The first one describes usual massless spin to graviton. Well, this one is a massive one, but with a wrong sign, actually a ghost. And the existence of this ghost makes the theory not unitary. So there are places with probability greater than one. And the existence of the ghost is closely related with including time derivatives higher than two. When we add this term, we have field equations of the fourth order, so time derivative of the fourth order. And we might recall the famous Ostrogradsky theorem from 1850, which states that the system is not kinematically stable if it is described by a non-degenerate higher time derivative Lagrangian, higher than 2. This implies that any higher derivative theory of gravity is not stable. One of the possible ways to evade this theorem is to include only higher order special derivative terms in the Lagrange, but still keeping the time derivative terms only up to second order. But when we add only special derivatives to Lagrangian, the Lagrangian is no longer invariant under form diffeomorphism. So this implies breaking Lorentz invariance in the high energy, the UV. And this is what actually Kojava proposed. So the basic assumption of this theory was to consider anisotropic scaling between time and space. So we have the scaling of time, the scaling of space. Here, Z is the dynamical critical exponent. And this is actually Lifshitz scaling used at the beginning of the previous century for condensed matter. Now, Lorentz invariance requires that Z is equal to 1. Mm-hmm. So we have to e to minus 1 and the same for space.
Mm-hmm.
But power counting renormalizability requires that Z, so this exponent is greater or equal the number of the spatial dimension of the space-time?
We usually consider 3 plus 1 space-time, so spatial dimension is equal to 3. And in the usual, we have a gravity formulation, we take this exponent equal to 3. So in the discrete scaling, we have the following dimension of T and space coordinates. And as I said before, this scaling explicitly breaks Lorentz invariance and for the diffeomorphism invariance. But I have to stress that it's only in the high energy limit of the theorem. So Hajala assumption was that, okay, four-dimensional diffeomorphism invariance is broken, but we will keep spatial diffeomorphism. And this symmetry is often referred as the foliation preserving field of diffeomorphism because we have 3 plus 1 foliation with spaces with constant time, and we have the diffeomorphism preserving the spatial mesh. Due to this invariance preserving foliation, it is convenient to write the action in terms in the language of the well-known ABM format. So this is one of the forms to write the action in this format. And here we have lapse, shift, and spatial metric, which are the dynamical variables, and we have conjugate momenta. Now, the most general form of the action in this language is this, is followed. So we have usual kinetic term, this is these first two terms, but we have additional parameter lambda here. I didn't mention that K is extrinsic curvature of the foliation of the space foliation. Before I will talk about gravitational potential, I will say some more about this lambda. This square and its trace square are individually invariant after foliation preserving diffeomorphism or free the diffeomorphism. But for lambda equal to 1, the whole the full kinetic term is invariant under a whole symmetry group of GR, so after for diffeomorphism. So this signals, and I will talk about this lambda later, that this is the parameter that shows us, tells us about deviations from Lorentz invariance.
Those IJ are space, but not space time, but space like.
Yes, this is the IGM format. And we have this term, this is gravitational potential, which depends, as I signaled before, only on the space parameters, not space time. So metrics and its derivative K, of different
orders. K square root K, does it contain also K zero or?
No, it's only for three-dimensional parameters. Similar that a lot was devoted in my PhD thesis, is in the same object. AJ are space indexes. So now different formulation of Hajala gravity are about different terms that are within the potential. This is probably not needed at the moment. The minimum formulation of Poiseuille gravity is the so-called detailed ballast formulation. It is based on the assumption that it should be possible to derive gravitational potential V from a superpotential dump as follows. So this is one assumption. The second one is about laps, which stands here. When we assume that laps depends only on time t, we have the so-called projectability condition. There are extensions of this theory where this condition is not assumed, but it leads to much more thermal gravitational action. That's why I call this minimum formulation of the theory with the minimum number of parameters and terms in the action. So this is the action of the detailed balance formulation of Poiseuille gravity. What do we have? Here we have some new parameters, omega, kappa, and mu. They have the following mass dimension. We have also the Cotton tensor. This is the Cotton tensor, so it contains derivative of scalar tensor of the curvature tensor. And maybe I will not go at this moment into details here. The first fact that it is expected that this action reduces to the Einstein-Hilbert one in the low energy limit of the theory. And it's not actually, it's not so straightforward to obtain this limit. But anyway, in order to achieve this, we have to express our parameters to connect them with the known physical constants like gravitational constant and speed of light. Here, lambda is something that will be later connected to the usual lambda in the Einstein equation, but it's a different parameter at the moment. So I will. Now some more about this coupled constant lambda, because this is what I wanted to focus on in this talk. So this coupling runs with logarithmically with energy, and it flows to the free infrared fixed points, 1 over 3, lambda equal to 1, and infinity. A lot of theoretical considerations show that in this middle region, there are those instabilities of the scalar mode of the theory. And some attempts to solve this problem resulted in instabilities in ultraviolet. From theoretical point of view at the moment, the most physically interesting case, this is the regime lambda greater than one or equal, which allows possible flow towards GR, which is recovered at lambda equal to one. Now the other region, lambda smaller than one third, is disconnected from the lambda equal to one, which gives us the classical gravity, Einstein gravity. So this parameter lambda is supposed
to control somehow or describe, not control the breaking of Lorentz invariance. So our work was about how the cosmological behavior of this gravity formulation changes with allowing lambda to vary, and compare to obtain lambda from the astronomical observation. And we also wanted to set bounds on the level of Lorentz violation described by this lambda at the energy scales available through astronomical data. To derive the equation of Ojava-Lipschitz cosmology, one uses the spatial part of the matrix being the usual Friedmann Robertson Walker line element. So we have here gamma ij is the maximalist metric metric with constant curvature. And values k equal to minus 1, 0, 1 correspond to closed, flat, and open universe. So this is very simple. This is very standard formulation. And just inputting this matrix into terms that we have interaction results in vanishing of the Cotton tensor. We have simple curvature like this, and the external curvature is the following. Here H denotes the Hubble parameter. So on this background, the gravitational action simplifies to the following one. Now, if we want to derive analogs to the Friedmann equation, we vary this action with respect to our dynamical variable n, and we set n equal to 1 at the end of calculation. We have to also populate our model with canonical matter and radiation field. They are represented by standard notation. Density of matter, this is density of radiation and corresponding momenta. They are also subject to the continuity of the equation. So this procedure leads to analogs of the Friedmann equations. What we see here? So we have a standard part, which is also here. But there are new terms which are inversely proportional to the a to the power 4, and the same here. This new term basically allows us to obtain a non-singular evolution towards a equal to 0. Because there is some model for finite A where this part is equal to 0. So I wrote, I think, 2 papers about possible cosmological solution results in bounds. So we go to the finite A and we expand. Now we require that our cosmological equation coincide with the standard Riemann equation. Of course, not all the terms, but just the usual terms. So we can express the gravitational constant by parameters of the Ojava-Lipschitz theorem here, and also other constants as well. When we want to restore Lorentz invariance, lambda is equal to 1, and the gravitational constant G is equal to cosmological constant G. And we have the also other simplification. So With all this notation, we can write our analog of the Friedmann equation suitable for numerical analysis like follows. Here we have standard terms, and we have another term here. So a very characteristic feature of Horowitz's theory is a dark radiation term, this one, that could be expressed also in terms of the effective number of neutrino spaces presented during BB and the fog, as follows. And another constraint is the z equal to zero limit, as follows. Now, having this constraint equation, I will skip at the moment the other formulation because it's just it goes beyond the basic results. And when we have the constraint equation, which I showed the precise back, we would like to estimate the values of the several gravity parameters that appear in this constraint. In this constraint equations. By using large astronomical data and the well-known Markov chain Monte Carlo method, which allows us to have probability distribution in the multidimensional space of all the unknown variables. Our data includes expansion rates of elliptical and lenticular galaxies, type some supernova, baryon acoustic oscillation, cosmic microwave background, and trios in the Hubble parameter, which I think is the problematic part of the data. We have used the parallelized Markov chain Monte Carlo method developed in Mathematica, because it is really longer than the ones written in Fortran or C, but we can easily add the additional data in this formulation, so we can add several group of data and exclude them easily. And also during every step in the computation, our method calculates the chi-square, and in the end returns the parameter set to which minimizes this function, so we have some information about this without knowing the actual probability distribution. Now a bit more about this data. So at early times, our base probes are the cosmic microwave background CMB and baryon acoustic oscillation. CMB originated at the quite high Z, where the temperature of the universe was around 3000 Kelvin, and the energies are of the order of electron volts. And this is complemented by BAO observation, and this observation also affects the distribution of local galaxies and are more sensitive to different parameters compared to C and B. We have also supernova type 1a, which are used more as standard rulers. They also output more energy than the rest of its whole galaxy. This is quite higher energy, but this energy is here less important, so we need them for to be distance rulers. We have also cosmic chronometer that data set, which is based on passively evolving galaxies, and gamma ray burst, which are the most violent explosion in the known universe, with the energies very high. Mm-hmm. But
The energies I talk about are energies of the event. They are not energies of gravitational field. So we have to remember that. And such high energies doesn't actually imply that this is high energy of gravitational field in this event. And now we have the data from different scenarios, from different not experiments but events, and we wanted to know how the parameter lambda controlling the deviation from Lorentz invariance behave if we exclude some sources or include some sources. We have the energy of the sources. We are not actually sure what are the energies of the gravitational field in this event, but they are different. So first we remove the Hubble parameter measurements from cosmic chronometers, and then we remove everything except the truly early universe probes when we expected to have gravitational field with higher energy. And what are the results? So in the minimum formulation, removing cosmic chronometer data pushes our parameter to take values close to you, so to the classical gravity. Further removing data, so all everything else about early universe data, moves it back up towards higher values and with much larger error bars. In a bit richer formulation, the situation is somewhat reverse. I just only mentioned. And in almost all scenarios, removing Hubble data from cosmic chronometers strongly pushes lambda close to low energy. Okay, so this is, those are the results. In detail at the balance formulation, we have two charts because remembering about theoretical problems with lambda smaller than one, we made some calculation imposing prior on lambda that it should be greater than one. So with all the data, we had lambda quite far from the value of one. We remove cosmic chronometers and we go very close to one. Then we remove all the data except early universe, and we again go back to the, we shift a bit into UV regime. When we don't impose this prior, we have we have similar behavior, but maybe this peak is narrow. So there are all the results. What are interesting here is the effective number of neutrino spices. This is the prior, but this is similar when we didn't impose the prior here. And the parameter, curvature parameter, which is negative, non-zero. Also the difference between gravitational cosmological constants and cosmological constant and gravitational constant is around 4%. So this is what I talked about. Our curvature parameter is not zero in actually all formulation of Rzhava-Lipschitz gravity, which point out to the closed universe. this closed universe has been found in several different analyses of Rzhava-Lipschitz cosmology. And this model actually differ across the universe with us. There are also some studies within the standard from lambda CDM theory using Planck data that point out to actually a closed universe, the plasma universe. But this result is quite sensitive to the amount of light in the sun. Also, other data sets like baryonic acoustic oscillation strongly favor a closed universe, again, under the assumption of lambda CDM. The third interesting result is the value of delta n, the number of effective neutrino spices, equal greater than 0.2. In almost all the cases. And in one scenario, at one sigma, it reaches very high results, 0.75. And we check this chain a lot of time. This chain passed a lot, all of conversions, practically here. So with all other parameters taking reasonable values comparable to other numerical results of other authors and using other codes, we might consider the possibility of a fourth neutrino spices that might be present in for avalanche cosmology. And there are some papers, recent papers, okay, 5 years ago. That this fourth neutrino might solve the H0 tension problem. But the authors there a very high number, and approximately 4. And this number is far higher than our result. And also, those two results, so one that curvature parameter is negative, and other that delta n is not zero. They are somehow connected because non zero delta n fits with the non Planck. And maybe the results from baryonic acoustic oscillation give a strong link for that. To summarize and point out the possible problem with these results, we have obtained it that in the minimal version of the Hojava gravity, the parameter controlling Lorentz invariance varies with the energies of our messengers, of our astronomical message. However, as I said before, we have to distinguish between gravitational energy, energy of the gravitational field, which is very high, for example, in pulsars, or at the very, very early universe beyond the stage we can reach with our messengers. And energy of the probes, which comes from different interactions. We also have to take into account hidden assumption on the problem. Our Hubble data was based on a model which was supposed to be non-dependent on the actual model of the universe. Because usual estimation of Hubble parameters are based on the lambda CDM model. We try to overcome this. But there are other assumptions in the data. This is not raw data, but there are assumptions for that. We probably don't control. We have also used the cosmological models based on the simple minimum Hojava gravity models.
which are subject to a lot of theoretical problems and a lot of discussion, the value and the sign of the cosmological constant lambda, and also the existence of the scalar mode of gravity, which has very tight observational bounds. So we don't know if it exists or not. But the tail balance model, so the most basic one, was the only model in Kozhava-Lipschitz gravity proven to be renormalizable and unitary. So this is what we want to have in order to build quantum gravity. And there are other works on Kozhava gravity, which somehow reinvents the tail balance models, like the recent interesting proposal of the linking Hawking non-binary proposal and the detailed balance mode. This is about the quantum wave of the universe. And also, in spite of problems shown in the classical projected Bohr version, so the version when we assume that the lapse time depends only on time, almost all the efforts made on quantum version of this theory seem to favor this version. So I think we showed, I sketched the result of our work, and I also tried to point out some flaws of our work, which might possibly disrupt the obtained result.
Question? Maybe,
so you are breaking this Lorentz invariance, which is a big price, this additional to cure the probability of renormalization. And then one can think how good the model is. What would be the gain of this model, and whether we can maybe test it? First of all, test it on the air. You think, is it possible? And the second question, is there are some further measurements which could support this model compared to other ones?
So, starting from the beginning of the question, so we have estimation. So we assume some gravity theory. If we wrote the we obtain analog of the Riemann equation, which contains additional terms which are similar to that radiation terms, this one. We simplify the obtained equation to the form which is suitable, which this is the standard form used in numerical calculation. And now we use data to estimate different parameters. I go back to results. So parameters that can be used to verify this theory is curvature parameter and Hubble parameter, because we can measure them in different ways. So those are parameters which comes from this model. And now I skipped, of course, not because about the Kozhava-Lipschitz gravity, because I have limited time. But this gravity predicts there is scalar mode, the scalar mass gravitons. And there is a search for this scalar mode. And I think in 2018, This mode was estimated using the pulsar data, GW, I don't remember the numbers at the moment, to something like 10 to minus 15 at the moment. So close to, yes, it's less than 10 to minus 15.
So in other words, the data are also compatible with zero?
Yes, but we have to remember that we search 100 years for gravitational waves. There are, we obtain zero for 100 years. But this is the one of the ways if we discover somehow this column, checking really sources with high gravitational fields, and these sources are actually pulsars, sources available to us. It might show that this theory, in some formulation, can be taken into account.
But for low energy, you expect such small differences, there will be out.
Yes, for smaller energies, we recover classical general relativity, because this model is severally experimentally verified. So we want to have classical limit.
I am an old man and I am unable mentally to accept any theory which is based on the existence of an absolute simultaneity, because existence of this foliation means that there are somewhere the books, and at each book they are listed all possible events which occurred on the same simultaneously. And
but this is only in high energy regime, high energy of gravitational field, when everything breaks.
Nevertheless, so this is very difficult for me, because we what we learned from Einstein is that we are unable to measure experimentally, to decide experimentally whether two events are or are not simultaneous, because the result depends upon who is measuring. So this is my first problem. And the other thing, this is just my comment, that when talking about renormalizability or non-renormalizability, I would first like to know what would be this future quantized gravitational field, because nobody told me, so it's difficult to discuss about this renormalizability, because it's only the discussion about the computational formulae, but this formulae should follow from the well-defined. I know what is a quantized electromagnetic field, even if nonlinear electrodynamics still does not exist, but at least the theory of non-interacting photons does exist, and I know what could be this quantized field, but in case of gravitational field, there is absolutely no idea what would it be and how I would feel this quantized field. Okay, thank you.
So first part of the question, we now assume that Einstein theory is something natural. When I read about this when I was 16 years ago, about different observations from different observers, it was mental shock for me. And it was mental shock for people 100 years ago. Now we get used to something, but maybe there is the next theory which changes the way of our thinking. So the fact that we are used to something shows limits of our probably what we know at the moment, not what can we know in the future. Second equation, quantum gravity, quantum Poissonian gravity is not yet built. It was proven to be renormally stable in 2016. There are, of course, on quantizing different models within this theory. So people take some model like, for example, Cantor-Fisak. They have Hamiltonian. They have this, they write Wheeler-DeWitt equation. And they have some results about the wave function. I haven't seen about energy levels. But this is just using the known methods, not using the quantum version of the whole theory. So I cannot answer about quantum gravity corresponding to that model because it's not yet developed.
So,
yes,
please.
So you introduced to define the model, you introduced high order derivative, one thing. Another thing is you introduced some difference, some parameter in the Lorentz invariance. Are these two procedure same and one follows from another, or you need both? You introduce just high order derivative. Is that all?
Yes.
Or it's not all. You have to introduce also something else, like the Z parameter.
So if there has been a lot of work done on Einstein gravity, adding higher terms to the action with on higher derivatives of the matrix here and plus other derivatives of the matrix. But the result here is not unitary. So it
can it's not what?
And not stable. So the idea was to add only
without
spatial derivatives because due to Ostrogradsky theorem, a theorem which has higher than two time derivatives in the Lagrangian is not stable. So to omit this, Poissonian introduced only
spatial
derivatives. And introducing spatial derivatives breaks four dimensional, four invariance of four diffeomorphic. And it has to be nicely described. So for that, there are these Lipschitz called scaling. And as I said, this is the minimal version of the theory based on this assumption that gravitational potential can be derived from superpotential W. It helps with the further quantization process, but probably maybe one has to consider a version with different potential, adding higher terms, omitting some here. We don't know it.
Thank you.
Other questions? Yeah.
What is this W, this superpotential?
Just something that we derive from our potential. It's not here, it's just.
But you have some explicit formula.
I have a question related to what Professor Kioski said. You use the terms taken from quantum field theory, like renormalizable theory or unitarity. Unitarity refers to the S matrix. And the question and renormalizable theories are also defined in terms of the S matrix. So my question is, what is this S matrix here describing? What kind of scattering do you consider in order to talk about unitarity?
I use the word unitary.
But unitarity has a well-defined meaning in theoretical physics. That means that the evolution is unitary. That means the probability is conserved. That means that you are talking about quantum theory, and the S matrix is needed here. Otherwise, the concept of renormalizability is not precisely defined.
Yes, I wanted to sketch only why classical gravity is not renormalizable. So this is only sketch, because I'm not talking about the problems of classical relativity, but why we could introduce other theory.
So you, what about the question of renormalizability? What does it mean in your theory to say that the theory is renormalizable? That means that in perturbation theory, you can remove the infinities by applying the procedure of renormalization. If you don't have the perturbation theory, then the question of renormalization does not even arise.
No.
Yes, that procedure was published in 2016 for Chorzowa gravity.
Yeah. Point by building. Thank you, Robert.
Can you expand your answer or finished?
But I don't exactly understand the question.
Well, the question was about the meaning of the term renormalizability in this context.
So we have we obtain the gravitational propagator, which cuts, which behaves well in higher energies and doesn't contain ghosts arriving in this formulation shown on this slide. Okay. This work that concerns normalizability of the theory are rather in this direction, not as matrix.
All right, I have just a simple question from astronomers' point of view, because I guess it's a bit confusing to hear about this UV and infrared behavior, yes, of lambda, but it is all connected with your radiation term in the Friedmann equation, not with the energy observed from astronomical sources, right?
No, it's about only energy of the gravitational field.
Mm-hmm. So does it matter if you use stars or gamma ray bursts or supernova that are emitting radiation in a very different wavelength?
We included different astronomical sources.
But you included them as a distance indicators?
Only supernova. Yeah.
You had separates also in the table, yeah.
Yes. What I wrote, we have available different sources. We have energies of these sources, but these are energies of the processes like in supernova, the first supernova.
Photon energy.
Yes, these are the photons. Which are different from the energy of gravitation of it. And we are thinking about using pulsar data, because this data is obtained from high energy gravitational field and is used for searching high energy effects in gravity, like gravity waves. And we want also to use that in our future calculations. There were problems with that. When we calculated this, so we didn't include it in actual. But as I said, there is a distinction between energy of the gravitational field and the energy of the process from which we have our messengers.
Mm-hmm.
So we can only observe the change of the result with excluding or including some sources. And we can speculate about the energies of gravitational field which correspond to the accident at the moment of sending messengers. But this is rather speculation than knowledge. And about neutrinos, just to clarify, you mean fourth species of the neutrino is the sterile neutrino, yeah? One called sterile. Okay, any other questions? Oh, please.
Proposed that this gravity theory is linear manageable, but at the lambda equal one, we can recover Lorentz symmetry, right?
Yes, it's not easy process, I thought that it's a problematic process, but yes.
But this lambda also depending on the energy scale, because when you actually renormalize the theory, it actually constant, physical constant can depend on the energy, right?
It corresponds to the energy of the system. It runs logarithmically with energy. But energy is the basic notion, and the parameter corresponds, is linked to the value of energy. So it's just a parameter, not some fundamental physical one.
But it runs with the energy.
Yes. And so we have three infrared points. And between them, there is some UV region, and there are a lot of works where, for which energies there is this UV region for quantum version of some quantized models within this gravity. And they check what are the behavior between, usually between lambda equal one and higher. And this is where the energies started to increase.
In that case, the Lorentz symmetry is broken.
Yes, right. Because even in the basic action, we see that for lambda equal one, we have the usual kinetic terms. With different one, it doesn't. It's not four dimensional or diffeomorphism invariant, and these terms are a bit more complicated to research. So I only demonstrate on kinetic terms.
I don't see any other questions, and we are out of time. So thank you again for coming.